I was invited today to talk to you a little bit about what we have within and on our bodies, what we have to call the meta-organism, human meta-organism. We do not think about microbiome in humans as just commensals. We think of them more of a symbiosis today. This because we have a very, very intimate relationship between the millions of organisms that are living together or with our millions of human cells. We have, of course, an amazing amount of data today. This is all thanks to next generation sequencing. Pretty much all the data that I'll be sharing with you is due to these new technologies that are came about maybe 8 to 10 years ago. And the field has really propelled itself for the last 12 years. We have come to see that the highest densely populated microbial environment within our body is the colon. We had a very good idea of that. Today we have better estimates of how many species are actually living there. The diversity is actually very, very high. So as I was saying, the microbiome is this incredible composition of microorganisms that we have living within us. It's not just bacteria as we try to think of them. We actually have a very, very large amount of all domains of life. We have archaea, we have viruses, we have, of course, bacteriophage, and we have fungi, not to mention the occasional parasite and the occasional protist living within us and on us. This makes for a very unique system, and it's actually really an ecological system. Each one of those parts of our body actually responds to that particular environment. So what we have in the nose is actually very distinct from what we have within our guts. That is, the nutritional and environmental conditions for those microorganisms are different. And of course, this will be impacting who is actually living there. They'll try to optimize the use of each one of those regions. So what I'm showing here, and I'll show some more graphs of this nature, is a principal coordinate analysis, and each point represents an entire microbial community. In this case, the entire bacterial complement of that community. The color codes represents where they came from in the human body. In this case, for example, in red we have the ear canal here, and in blue we have samples from the gut. And we can see that the distances represent similarity or distance between the samples. So all those samples from the gut share something in common. Their microbial composition actually reflects all the needs that you have to be within the gut and fulfill those physiological functions that we have within the gut. They're adapted, of course, to the leftover food as the main source of energy. So everything we eat will influence the microbiome. Conversely, the microbiome will actually influence our health. And we have a feedback loop, and our health will actually influence the microbiome back. We have, because of those reasons, within this last 12 years, we have come to think of this as a symbiosis. We know that this is true for a long time, actually. Since the dawn of the germ-free mice system, we have noticed that those mice were actually abnormal. Whenever you actually try to isolate the mouse component from the system and make it completely free of germs, free of microorganisms, it would not develop its human immune system correctly. There were actually even anatomical changes that were visible. And this is actually restored if you put back some bacteria inside of the system again. So we do need the bacteria to completely complete their development. Of course, we do not have human germ-free systems because, we're human. But we do understand that there's a lot of influence within our development, especially within the human the immune system, throughout the early age, the first 2-3 years of age. We have come to understand that we have a very good relationship with several inflammatory diseases. We're not entirely sure if this is a marker or causing agent, so we're still trying to understand those systems. We have come to understand that there's a relationship with obesity. The energetics of the system is actually influenced by signaling coming from the microbiome. So all those relationships point to symbiosis. They are receiving something from us, and we are receiving something from them in turn. As I said, all of this started about 12 years ago, so it's a relatively new field as we understand it today. Of course, we know about bacteria and fungi living within the human body for a very long time, but we have come to appreciate it in a different light with the advent of next-generation sequencing. Just as an example, this paper was published in 2005, and at that time, you know, three volunteers yielded this number of sequences that you guys see. This was using the technology available at that time. Today, what we have is a completely revolution in the way that we gather data. We have changed it from rooms and rooms and rooms full of sequencers of that nature to one single machine that does the same job of those, you know, entire rooms full of equipment. That was intermediate generation sequencing, and today we actually are working mostly with Illumina-based sequencing technologies, which provide us up to 6 billion sequences in one single run. So the amount of data is really, really different. What this means is that we can address different questions. Today, of course, we're not working with just three individuals. This is a very recently published paper, and just to give an idea, what they actually did was work with two independent cohorts, and there are over 2,000 people in this cohort. They were sequenced completely, and the wealth of data actually allowed us to see relationships that were completely unknown to us. Some of them were expected. They were related to diet, for example. So what we have here are measures of relationship, their covariates with one of the cohorts, and the replication within the other validation cohort. And the strength of the relationship is the size of the bar. So some of the bars we actually understand, and we expected that, but some of them we didn't. For example, why would the hemoglobin measured in the blood be so much, you know, have such a strong relationship with the gut microbiome? Why would age actually be related to the gut microbiome? And actually, the microbiome is one of the few markers that we have today for age. We cannot precisely pinpoint age, but we actually do know that there is a relationship and there's a change of the microbiome with age. We do not have any other biological marker that would be able to tell us this person is old and this person is young, just based on genetics, for example. Maybe telomeres, but we're not quite there yet. So the microbiome has all these interesting relationships, so we still do not understand why they're there. Some of them we're starting to understand. Like I said, the systems are different within the human body, reflecting the needs that the bacteria have to live there. What we have here is just a representation of the microbial communities living within the oral cavity and intestinal cavity. This is a cohort of about 100 people that was published some time ago by the Human Microbiome Project in the United States. What we have is a representation of major phyla of bacteria. So we have here in blue the Bacteroidetes phyla, for example, in the intestinal component of these people. And you can see that from one person to another one, we have a very, very large variation in the number of bacteria. So this person is almost entirely colonized by Bacteroidetes, whereas this one on this side is actually only about 50% colonized by this. So we have a very, very large variation in the bacteria that are living there. Nevertheless, they still have to fulfill the functions within the gut. So if you look at the function that those bacteria have, the genes that are encoded by the same sample and the same bacteria, we actually see that there is a very large similarity in the functions that are actually observed within this gut. So this is just to exemplify that we have a large variation in colonization in who actually is present, but what they're doing is actually similar to one another. So what we actually are shifting today is not so much as the description of actually the bacteria that are present or fungi or whatever, but to the functions that actually are present. And this makes difference. This makes a very, very large difference because we're not looking to change or modulate a species, but we should be looking to change or modulate a function that's actually being done by many species within the gut. This is all to say that we're talking about bacteria. We haven't even touched about the phage. for each bacterial cell that we have, it's estimated that we have 10 particles of phage, the natural predators of the bacteria. This in any normal person. So how is this interplay of prey and predators actually taking place every day within us is still unknown. We do not know who is regulating who and how that's happening. But it is certain that there is regulation happening, and we actually have some evidence in the literature already that phage play an important part even within our immune system function. I have talked so far about bacteria. I have not touched the surface yet of all the groups of organisms living within our gut. We have here just a representation as a heat map of bacteria in the middle and archaea and fungi in the bottom. The colors represent how much we have of that genus. For each one of those groups. So, again, about 96 individuals here. All individuals are in the columns, and the rows are actually each taxon here. The colors, of course, represent how much we have. So, the bacterial world is here. We have seen several of that in the literature. The different information here is what we have in terms of fungi, for example. In this cohort, it was detected 66 fungi genera within these people. Those are just the most prevalent within the cohort. What are all these fungi doing within our gut? The normal stuff, we have an idea. Saccharomyces, which was detected, and it is here, pretty much everybody has. We know that. We eat Saccharomyces for a very long time. So it's not unexpected to actually see Saccharomyces in the gut. Wine, bread, beer, all of those are part of our diet. We expect to see them. What we don't expect to see is, for example, candida. Why would some people have so much candida within their guts? And what does that mean as a reservoir for a potential pathogen? Candida is one of those fungi that is an opportunist. It will actually cause infection if it has an opportunity for it. So what does that mean for health systems and how to deal with that information? And finally, on the top here, we have archaea. They are the third domain of life. They're prokaryotes. And if anybody within this room has ever heard about methane production within our guts, you're actually thinking about archaea. There is only one source of biological production for methane, and that's archaea. So 30% of us are producing methane within our guts right now, and that's thanks to one group of methanogenic archaea, the methanobrevibacter. We know that for quite a little while, it's about 30% of the population that's positive for that, and this study actually found that about 16% of people actually have a completely new group, which we still don't know what's doing there, but apparently 15% of us have it, and it's called the drososphere. There were no very strong relationships with any signal, but perhaps it's related to proteins metabolism, as it is actually in other systems related to nitrogen cycling. So far we have seen just a description of everything that's within us. So I'll try to give you a little bit of an overview of one of the factors that actually may influence the gut microbiome. Of course, we have many points of influence. We have our genetics and phenotype is an expression of our genetic background. We have the state that we are right now of inflammation, if we have an infection or not. Of course, antibiotics have been known for a very long time. We all understand that. You put antibiotics in the system and you kill bacteria. That's what they're supposed to do. That, conversely, will also affect the human microbiome. So, which is one of the reasons why we probably shouldn't be using antibiotics so much as we use today. The last point, and the one that I'm going to attain myself today, is diet. It is the easiest point to manipulate the gut microbiome. It's the source of energy is what they use to eat. If they eat, there's leftover. If there wasn't leftover, there wouldn't be anything coming out on the other side. So there's stuff getting to the gut, and that's the food of the bacteria. Okay? So everything that we eat will have an influence within the gut microbiome. This story was shown in a very, very beautiful paper published some time ago. And this relationship actually plays across all domains of vertebrate life. What was shown is that you have a very, very large segregation of samples across all animals that you can actually look just based on the bacteria within their guts. You can actually classify them as herbivores, carnivores, and omnivores separated from the other two, just based on the bacteria within the gut. We see that as this nice little bundle of sticks within the screen. This is actually a network analysis, and in green we have the herbivores, in blue the omnivores, and the red the carnivores. The part that was novel here is that these relationships of gut and host, gut microbiome and host, is actually very, very ancient. The second separation that we saw was that the different types of animals can actually be segregated just by the gut bacteria. So if you take all the taxa here with those colors, we can actually see that they are segregated within the network analysis too. So for example, we have a little bunch of all insectivora right over here. We have the different taxa presented within those colors here. So this relationship between the gut microbiome and vertebrates is actually very, very ancient. You can actually show that it actually follows the same phylogeny, the same evolutionary history that those vertebrate groups have. And of course, we see that relationship with diet. The story within humans actually became a little bit more interesting when the paper that I'm presenting to you now actually was published. So this was a study conducted by an Italian group, and they compared Italians, of course, with a group of individuals from Burkina Faso. It was a rural village. We have here a little the picture. And the idea here was actually to get very, very distinct lifestyles, including diet, but healthy people. They were all healthy, understanding all the differences within the scenario. You know, of course, suburban Italians and rural Africa. But the idea was to actually see if they could detect the differences in the gut microbiome of those people. And one of the differences that they pointed out was diet, and I'll show you too. So as the microbiome goes, we have then here the separation, and this is just a clear representation in the pie chart of those people. We have here the individuals from Burkina Faso being heavily populated by one phylum, whereas it's very much reduced within the Italians in green here. And I'll point some general for you. We have here 50% of the gut microbiome of the Burkina Faso people actually is colonized by Prevotella, whereas that genus is completely absent within the Italians. So this was the first time that a larger cohort with healthy individuals actually showed this very, very profound differences within the gut microbiome of normal, healthy humans. They did not have very strong signals for other variables, like I said, they were all healthy, but they did point out to diet as being one of the potential influences to actually create this difference. The diet of the Italians is probably well known to most of the people here. It's what we today would call the Mediterranean diet. So it does have quite a good amount of protein in it. It does have carbohydrates, it has fruits and vegetables. But the diet within the Burkina Faso village is actually very poor in protein, if you think in terms of animal protein especially. They do have access to dairy, but they usually just drink the milk. And for a younger population, which this is actually a younger population, they use a lot of carbohydrate-based food. And that's very, very minimally produced. It's actually produced in the village. This is usually sorghum or maize. So they proposed that this difference in the amount of carbohydrates was one of the driving factors to actually see these differences between Prevotella, for example, appearing in so large numbers within the gut of the Burkina Faso individuals. Not too after that, a little bit after that, we saw a very large study, a very interesting study coming from Europe. Actually, they were able to segregate again populations just based on their gut microbiome. So they went ahead and sequenced several individuals from a diverse array of countries from Europe, and actually saw that you could create clusters of people based uniquely on their bacteria. They named this the enterotype. So people could actually be put into one of those enterotypes. They observed three enterotypes in that population, and the part that was interesting is that relationship with those same genes that were actually observed in the previous study. So people that are actually from this cluster, they tend to have a lot of Prevotella within their gut, whereas people from the other clusters, they have very little Prevotella within their guts. And people from the cluster 1, they're the bacteroides enterotypes, they have a lot of bacteroides within the gut, whereas people from the other two clusters, they tend to have very little. The third cluster that they detect here was actually marked by, in this case, by the presence of Rhodococcus, and they replicated that in other cohorts that are already published. So this was the first time that we actually were able to segregate people within clusters of individuals just using the bacteria, and we actually saw marker genera for those guts. They were not able to explain why this was happening. They didn't have that kind of data. But they also didn't have diet data. Shortly after that, another cohort was published now in... pardon, this reference is wrong. This is actually the reference for the previous paper. This is the correct reference here. For 100 individuals actually from the US at this time. And what they saw was two of those same enterotypes. They were not able to clearly distinguish the third enterotype. And what they had here actually was diet. They were able to then correlate this information, the segregation of people in clusters of individuals based on the bacteria with the diet that they actually consumed. This is just a distribution of the same genera, again, Prevotella bacteroides for each one of the individuals in the cohort. You see that some people have quite a bit of Prevotella, whereas others have none within their gut. As I was saying, they did have access to diet data. They actually used food frequency questionnaires and recall data to assess usual diet and recent ingested diet. And what they were saw, what they actually saw and were able to show, was that there is a relationship of those segregations with their usual diet. What you eat all the time, your dietary pattern actually influences what your microbiome is. Today, if you eat something yesterday, and some of you probably had some quite a good amount of meat last night, being Argentine and all, that will have an influence in your gut, but it will tend to come back. That is a more transient shift within the gut system. You need to have a very prolonged pressure within the system to shift it from one direction or another. That assuming normal diet. If you want to shift it drastically, you need drastic change within your diet. So today we know that we can actually change the enterotype, for example, of the person, but we need very, very strong shifts in a very short period of time. Otherwise, this is a progressive process that happens over a long period of time. And the relationship that was shown, just to finish this part, is that the people from the enterotype 1, the bacteroides people, they are people that tend to eat meat. They are carnivores in the system. We have here all the amino acids and fatty acids, and if you can read, you don't have to worry about this, it's all published. This is positive correlations here, those are correlations of spearmint. The red we have the positive ones, and in blue we have negative ones. So people from the bacteroides, they are positively correlated with the intake of protein and negatively correlated for the other enterotype. The people from bacteroides, conversely, they tend to eat less carbohydrates, here broken down into their sugars from their diet, whereas the people from the Prevotella tend to eat a lot of those carbohydrates. So this was in one single cohort where they actually had that information between diet and microbiome, and they were able to make the relationship that yes, people from one type of enterotype tend to eat much more of one nutrient, micronutrient in this case, the Prevotella people being the ones that are eating a lot of carbohydrates. And this was nice because that was what was postulated by the people from Burkina Faso, saying that that was one of the reasons why they were seeing so much Prevotella within their guts as well. This, of course, only addresses the subject of microbiome within European and Americans. And since we started this, we have started discovering that that's not necessarily a very simple question. All the story of enterotypes has been described in Americans and Europeans, Western diets, Western world. But we have noticed over the years that there are distinctions between the microbiome across the world. So what I'm showing to you here are several studies that are actually a larger cohort of people, some of them larger than others, comparing usually an American group to groups from other continents. So we have here two ethnic groups from Africa. We have Bantu over here, and they are clearly different from the Americans in gray. We have here, again, Italians and Hadza from Africa, a very interesting group, just recently published on Nature, again about them. This is a comparison between people from Papua New Guinea and the U.S. We have here, again, people from the U.S. and people from Venezuela. Mirina is actually from South America, and people from Malawi. And I'll finish noticing this nice reworking of some data that was published previously. This shows the segregation between all the Americans on this cohort and all people that were actually sampled in Malawi and Amerindians from Venezuela. And you can see that there's a huge shift between those two populations. And we don't see that here. And this is not necessarily clear why, although diet is probably one of the biggest players here. Both populations actually have a very, very heavy component of carbohydrate within their diet. All the story of enterotypes is segregated to this type of people. So we have a lot of things that actually haven't been answered about those clusters of individuals around the world. And we're hoping that this will actually be studied further within the next years. I'll finish just giving one final example of where we are integrating all this data. So far I gave you populational data, very nice overview of what's happening in the microbiome of everybody. But in the end, most people that are working with the gut microbiome actually are interested in trying to fulfill a niche of medical sciences. They're trying to answer a question: can we use this to treat someone? Can we use it as a marker? Can we actually manipulate the gut microbiome in a way that will actually be beneficial for the population, or at least know so that we can intervene earlier? And what I'm going to show is actually a very interesting example that's in the literature, and it has a very nice beginning, middle, end, and maybe future perspective. And it has to do with atherosclerosis. This is completely not novel to anybody that actually knows anything about heart disease. It's a disease that we actually know for quite a while. What we didn't know is that why there are some people that have so many risk factors and don't develop the disease, whereas you have other people that have no risk factors and do develop the disease. So there's still a lot of unexplained questions within this. And what this researchers from the Hazen group actually were able to show was that you have several chemicals in the blood. They did very large cohort studies to show that you actually had interesting markers within the blood that are actually good predictors of the development of atherosclerosis and cardiovascular disease. So we have here just odds ratio for three different compounds that were published some time ago. Choline, triethylamine, and methane. So choline, of course, we know where it's coming from. It's from basically meat, rich in fat usually. But triethylamine was not known why would it be related to cardiovascular disease, and the odds ratio for this chemical is actually very, very large. The compound is actually not unknown. We have a wealth of studies from this type of compound from genetic disorders. So they were very curious why would actually detect so much of this in people that have such a high risk of developing cardiovascular disease, and we didn't know anything about it to that point. They went on to do a 3-year follow-up study to actually see if they could actually predict cardiovascular risk based on what they detected in the beginning of this study as far as TMO goes. So about 4,000 people were followed, and people that had the highest amount of TMO within their blood system actually were the ones that developed the highest amount of cardiovascular disease, including stroke and death. So that was a very, very strong predictor for cardiovascular disease in the prospective study. If you feed choline as a sourcer, one of the chemicals that detect to mice, they actually are able to induce atherosclerosis just by adding choline to the diet. And if you treat these mice with antibiotics, that effect goes away. What we have here is just plaques being formed. Those are foam cells that actually is a say system, and what we can see is that the control diet actually don't form those plaques, and the ones that receive the choline within the diet do form, and once you treat with antibiotics, then they all go away. And they did other studies throughout the years with other chemicals and with TMO, and they saw the same effects. And that actually made a very, very strong suggestion that the microbiome had some sort of relationship with this inflammatory process that actually was leading to something that was related to atherosclerosis. Through a series of animal studies, cohort studies, and in vitro studies, they actually were able to create a very interesting proposal of why we actually have this relationship. Well, we receive in our diet as fatty acids, folate, choline, carnitine, and retinol itself, TMA, actually, trinitylamine, is actually converted by our guts normally into trinitylamine, which is naturally absorbed and converted in the liver to trinitylamine oxide, TMAO. This is the compound that's normally found within our bodies. It's normal hepatic metabolism to make this conversion. We do that forever. That's what the bacteria were supposed to be doing. What is happening is that we are eating a lot of the input that actually produces TMAO within our system. And the TMAO is actually what's doing the problem. It's actually affecting a very large number of systems within our body. It doesn't affect just one single point. It changes the expression of genes within enterocytes, it changes the expression of genes within hepatocytes, and it does change the expression of several genes within the macrophage foam cells. So we have very large systemic changes that are actually always starting within that one compound coming from our gut. That is a simplified vision of what is happening, but in essence, it is true. We actually have large effects that are away from the point of origin within the body. And their example actually holds true for choline, carnitine, and even TMA being ingested. We know that this is actually the responsible for this conversion because there's a genetic disease that actually, for some people that don't have this enzyme active, and the enzyme that converts TMA to TMAO. And these people, unfortunately, have no cure. The only management that they can actually do for the disease is dietary restriction to prevent the ingestion of the sources that actually will lead to the conversion by the bacteria into TMA. So we had this idea coming from a completely different disease that now can actually be contextualized within our entire metabolic system in healthy people. If we do have that happening in those genetic disease people, we do have it happen in other people as well. After all, it's all coming from the diet. So they proposed this system, and today we have a very good understanding that this actually holds true for pretty much everybody. What I haven't shown you was who is actually doing that in the gut. And there is no who. This is very, very recent data, and it took quite a while for us to identify which one are the genes that actually are responsible for that conversion. What we have is actually at least this many clades of genes doing the same function within the gut. So each circle here is one person, okay? And the colors represent how much that person has of that one type of gene. They all have the same function. So this person here has clade blue, and this person here has basically clade orange, and they do the same thing. They both convert TMA. They both convert trinitylamine compounds into TMA. So that makes it very difficult for us to target these genes or bacteria itself as something that could actually be used for treatment to actually shift the microbiome in a direction or another, because each person tends to be very different. This is a general part of the metabolism. Of course, some people were a bit clever than that, and they didn't have this data, of course, at the time, and they decided that they could bypass the hepatic system. What if we can just remove the TMA from the equation? If we could do that, then we don't have the increased amount of TMA being absorbed and converted into TMAO. They actually proposed this very, very interesting concept called ARC biotic. What they saw was that you have a methanomycetococcus. It's a methanogenic archaea from the gut. They isolated it from a French individual. And they actually were able to show that you can grow this bacteria in the presence of TMA, and you actually produce methane. So whenever you do that, methane is an end product within the gut. We have no other ways of converting it into anything else. It usually is just expelled as gas. So they proposed that this was a very good candidate for a probiotic, that you could actually add this to the system and it would remove the TMA from the gut into methane before it got absorbed. So this is a very clever way of using all the knowledge that was acquired throughout many years of research to try to solve the problem. You actually remove the molecule, a single type of molecule, into something that's inert. Of course, this is just a proof of concept. They have disappeared from the literature later. If anybody knows anything about this, I would be very happy to hear about it. I'm very curious about it. But I can only assume that somebody's doing something with a strain to try to grow it. Unfortunately, growing anaerobic conditions is not very easy. But the idea was very interesting. You remove the TMA before it gets absorbed and convert it into TMAO. Consequently, you reduce it. I will just finish here, and I'll be happy to take questions at the end. I hope I gave you a good overview of what is happening, how we're getting the data, and the other speakers will actually try to convey specific examples of where we are today and how we got here this last year. And I hope you guys enjoyed it.